who wielded chains and beat up people who had long hair, and it became a kind of a war between what was and this kind of new hardcore scene. She wasn't what you call a babe, really.
She wasn't a woman. Along with the Misfits, there were some people that were genuinely psychotic. A song like Johnny Hit and Run Pauline, we won't play anymore because I've seen too many 19 and 20 year old boys, men, boy men, going like this, Johnny Hit and Run Pauline, and don't understand that it's an anti-rape song. And they're like into it for the wrong reason, so we don't play that anymore.
This hardcore scene was particularly scary and violent, and it was what gave punk a bad name. We kept begging them to stop spitting at us.
Spitting on your heroes has been popular, you know, ever since in different ways. And maybe that's okay, and maybe that was the part of punk was the thing about the anti-hero, really.
As soon as the people got hold of the idea that, all right, it's punk, we get it. We got it. And then when we started to play other things, they didn't like it. I mean, people still hate us in England for making it in America. I'm glad we did. Somebody had to break out and prove that this thing was a global thing.
When you step into that public arena, on one hand, it's maybe where some of the greatest possibilities are located. At the same time, it's the most dangerous place because it's where you're most easily subverted.
To reach a wider audience, you have to give something up. It's not a blinding rush for fame. You're expressing a soul, and you've got to do it in the right way. When you're struggling to get somewhere, the struggle can really hold you together. What killed us was success. For some reason, we weren't prepared. We'd spent like 5 years getting there. Perhaps after 5 years, we'd said our piece, if you like. A lot of the great groups didn't exist for very long.
To lump artists like the Sex Pistols, the Clash, and Elvis Costello under the banner of punk is really an indication of how categories fail. And I suppose everybody wanted one band to do it, like it happened with the Beatles. And it turned out not to be one band, but a lot of bands, a lot of journalists, a lot of young record people who went into the record companies and changed them. And therefore it's had a lasting effect.
Punk rock wasn't necessarily very musical or melodic, and I think new wave is when things, you know, a few jangly guitars and melodies, I guess. I don't know.
Punk did not die quietly, but in an explosion that sent rock music in different directions, creating boundless new ideas.
We thought we were a punk band for about a minute. Very early on, just after we'd figured out our bar chords, realized that we wanted to say more than goth. Even though there was some pretty cool ways of saying goth around at the time.
New wave was watered down. That was the complete corruption of everything. That's where everybody tried to be nice all over again. Don't be nice, it's the kiss of death.
We were trying to change something. The music industry, the way we live, you know, to be accepted any way we want to.
I've always believed that the esoteric or underground music of one generation becomes the pop music of the next generation. You know, there's jazz purists whose job is to keep it pure and the same. Rock and roll is the opposite. Rock and roll started as a bastard, as a hybrid. It was never pure to begin with.
American corporations took 10 or 15 years to recover from the shock of the Sex Pistols and the fluke of actually managing to sell the Clash to the general public, to really take a step back and find Nirvana and a few other bands.
You know what happened is that punk said, we're fed up with Pink Floyd, Jethro Tull, Led Zeppelin, the sort of skeleton of the Beatles, let's have some music from the street. And what's happened in America in 1991-90 is that you finally got your own punk. I know that that type of success is very, very, is stressful on you, you know? It's very stressful. And because you're constantly, you feel yourself, you think you feel yourself slipping away in some fashion. You know, maybe you're not, maybe you are, you know?
It's like a fire, and it burns and it burns and it burns and it burns, and that sounds like a sort of kind of a romantic fire idea until you realize that what's keeping the fire alight is bodies.
I think rock and roll exists to deliver this truth that needs to be constantly delivered. Rock, hip hop, whatever you call it. It reminds us, like this unspoken message is that it is fun to be alive. It's a hell of a lot better than being dead.
I think that my whole life was saved and opened up and made into a real life by my favorite singers, by the stuff that went before.
Rock and roll's always thrived on people not necessarily willfully throwing things into the mix, but sort of stumbling on things, crossing over short circuits and misconnections, and the people who have the tight, you know, spandex pants on and their hair just so and the guitar at the right angle, you know, aren't it at all, you know, the cigarette coming from the lip like this, because it's a facsimile of something that was previously rock and roll doesn't make it rock and roll forever. It's somebody in a bedroom somewhere doing something you haven't heard yet, with any luck.